Morning everyone. Today under quantity technology we will study chloride attack, corrosion reaction, corrosion damage and sulfate attack. We will deal with all these attacks briefly. Under chloride attack, when the chloride attacks the passive layer which has pH value of 12 to 13 or 11 to 13 is being penetrated by chloride, and that chloride which is having extra electron within enters through the passive layer by penetrating into it and destroying into it the steel bar, and then take away the Fe plus 2 with that. So the reaction which will take place when the chloride enters or penetrates into the passive layer and reach toward the steel rebar is FeCl2, where Fe plus 2 C minus went into two different electrons. So in last class we have dealt with carbonation. So unlike carbonation, there is no overall drop in pH. So while chloride attacks, there is no significant drop in the pH value. Chloride act as a catalyst. Chloride only act as a catalyst to corrode or to break down the passive layer. So it just acts as a catalyst and it corrodes the steel by breaking down the passive layer. Breaking down the passive layer allows the corrosion process to proceed quickly. So once the passive layer is being penetrated and destroyed, it is easy for the chloride ion to enter into the system where the steel bar is there and corrode it quickly. Now the Indian Standard 456 of 2000 print has specified some limit for the chloride, and that limits are concrete containing metal and steam cured at elevated temperature and pressure concrete should have a maximum total acid soluble chloride content, which is expressed in kg per meter cube, so it should have 0.4 kg per meter cube of chloride. Reinforced concrete or plain concrete containing embedded metal should have 0.6 kg per meter cube of concrete chloride volume or mass. The concrete not containing embedded metal or any material should have 3.0 kg per meter cube. These are the quantities and limits which the IS code, which is 2000, has imposed on the concrete. The IS 456 also said that you can also have chloride content pre-mixed into the concrete matrix by about 0.1%. Earlier it was 0.05%. Now, what happens in corrosion process? So there will be one electrode with one anode and another will be cathode. So at anode, Fe breaks down into Fe plus 2 plus 2 electrons, and at cathode reaction, that 2 electrons mix with water and another half molecule of oxygen will mix, and that will create 2OH minus, and that 2H one minus which mix with Fe plus 2, which presented anode, mix with Fe plus 2 and forms into FeOH whole thrice. And that Fe, that 4 molecules of FeOH2 plus O2 plus 2H2 will form 4 Fe, 4 molecules of FeOH whole thrice. And that whole thrice, 4 molecules will, the 2 molecules of that convert into Fe2O3.H2O plus H2O, and that results in the rust. And the rust which is produced by this chemical reaction by corrosion of iron or steel bar will occupy more space than the bar itself, and that will create space and it will rust and will pop out from the element. Now what happened at ionic, what happened inside the cathode and anode? So from as we know that we have started from anode, so 2 electrons will run from anode, and then ionic current will go start from anode and reach to that electron will reach to the cathode, and that cathode again, from cathode the electron moves towards the anode once again, and that whole process turns into a this turns into the this is ionic current, and then from cathode to anode it will turn into electronic current, and that current will help to help in corrosion of steel. And this is how this happens within the element of the structure. Now, in corrosion damage, the volume of Fe2O3 is 2 times the volume of Fe. So, as I said, it swells, and it swells, then it will occupy more space, and that the distress will appear on the concrete element, and it will result into the failure of the material or element. Then the swelling amount, the rust which will swell, Fe2O3.H2O. So it swells more into the amount, and the volume at steel or concrete interface, the interface of the steel and concrete, is 2 to 10 times the volume of Fe. That's why the whole result of this is the swelling of rust, and that will result into spalling. And that spalling is distress, and it produces spalling and as well as cracking, and it in the end result in the concrete deterioration. This is the summary of corrosion damage, which will result in concrete deterioration. Now the last thing is sulfate attack. Sulfate attack is a chemical reaction which breaks down the, which is a breakdown mechanism where sulfate ions attack components of the cement paste. So when sulfate ion attacks component of the cement paste, so that this exactly is known as the sulfate attack. The compounds responsible for sulfate attack are water soluble in sulfate containing salts such as alkali earth and calcium of magnesium, and alkali sodium potassium sulfates and all this, and then are capable of chemically reacting with the components of the concrete. So that it will enter through the pore of the concrete element. Now sulfate attack might show itself in different forms depending on the chemical form of sulfate, atmospheric environment where the element of concrete is exposed. So what happens when sulfate gets into the concrete? It combines with CSH, calcium silicate hydrate, or the CSH gel or paste, and begins destroying the paste that holds the concrete together. So we know already that CSH gel is an adhesive, and that holds together the entire mix. If it starts attacking to the CSH gel, then it's attacking to the core. And if it is attacking to the core, the adhesive property, the adhesiveness of that will be weaker, and that will result in the collapse of the structure, and the battery structure is built within the concrete. As sulfate dries, new compounds are formed, often termed as adtringing. These new crystals occupy empty space, and as they continue to form, they cause the paste to crack further because of the swelling of this, further damaging the concrete element. Now, sulfate sources, what are the sources from where we get the sulfate? One is internal sources. This is more rare, but originates from such concrete making material as hydraulic cements, fly ash, aggregate, and admissions. So, sulfates may come from the elements which we add as admixtures into the cement, from the aggregates if they are not washed, a proper kilnation is done, and fly ash, another mineral admixture which we mix with. And that is how the Portland cement might get over sulfated. So the sulfate has a limit. So that limit has been crossed, and then the Portland cement is over sulfated. Presence of natural gypsum in the aggregate. So if you have added more gypsum into the aggregate, then gypsum has sulfate, CaSO4, and that sulfate will start destroying the subject element. Admixtures, as I said before, admixture also can contain small amount of sulfate. So we have seen the internal sources. Now external sources. External sources of sulfate are more common and usually are a result of high sulfate soils and groundwaters, or can be the result of atmospheric or industrial water pollution. So external is your element is exposed to the environment which has sulfate or pollution from sulfate and all these things. That can enter into the system of the element. Or if you are building site has high sulfate soil, or the sulfate content of soil is more, then from there it can take sulfate and destroy the building. Soil may contain excessive amount of gypsum or other sulfate. So this is how from soil we can get sulfate. Groundwater be transferred to the concrete foundations, retaining water and other underground structures. So if groundwater is polluted with or it has more amount of sulfate, from there we can get the sulfate into the system. And rest is industrial wastewater. So if you use industrial water for the cooling purpose and for the purpose of making any element of the concrete, then from there you can get the sulfate and the sulfate into the system of the concrete. Now, sulfate attack processes decrease the durability of concrete by changing the chemical nature of the cement paste under the mechanical properties of the concrete. So, the sulfate attack changes the durability and the durability of the concrete and the mechanical properties as well. How it changes the durability? As we know that durability comes from if the concrete structure has minimum pores on its surface and uses the methods followed for making a highly durable concrete, which is termed as special performance concrete or high performance concrete, that concrete is termed as highly durable concrete and used for the structure for which they are designed. So if you use these sulfates into it and by accidentally, intentionally or unintentionally, that will result into the deterioration of the concrete. Not only deterioration of durability, but deterioration of mechanical properties as well. So the chemical process which takes place during attack of this bisulfate ion. In the sulfate ion which attacks to the hardened calcium aluminate or calcium hydrate compounds of the hardened cement paste and water, that all mix together to form aggregate which is calcium sulfur aluminate hydrate, and this is the reaction. This is how the aggregate is formed. This is the chemical reaction which takes place inside the element which we have discussed before. Another reaction, if you add gypsum, so sulfate ion in gypsum plus hydrated calcium aluminate or calcium hydroxide, and again hardened cement, it adds all together. The chemical reaction is being formed. That chemical reaction forms CaSO4H2, which is gypsum. This is how gypsum is formed, and again gypsum will cause sulfate attack. Now there are only two chemical processes from chemical sources. Now one physical process is also there, that complex physico-chemical processes of the sulfate attack are interdependent with the chemical process as in this reading. Yeah, so these both physical process and chemical process are interdependent, because once the chemical process takes place, then it will have its impact which will be visible physically on the subject element. Physical sulfate attack often evidenced by bloom at exposed concrete surface. So bloom is more like spalling, as it increases volume, and again there will be different colors will be there. You can see the colors, exposed surface colors, and colors of yellowish color. So those colors will be which is scattered around the surface of the subject element. We term them as blue. It is not only a cosmetic problem, but it is the visible displaying of possible chemical and microstructure problem within the concrete masses. So surface, by seeing the blue or different colors and the haziness on the subject element, we must not consider that it is the problem only cosmetic, which can be cured through the processes, but it is a problem or a distress which may have deep rooted into the element and may be destroying element from the root itself. So we have to be very sure while detecting the sulfate attack, and then we have to take the prevention according to the methods employed for the prevention of sulfate attack. So for time being, we will be discussing up here only, and we will be discussing few further topics in the next lecture. Thank you.